Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken.
Good morning, everyone. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior. Thank you for joining us this morning for a talk about something that is close to each one of us in many different ways. We have Brother Edsel Burge joining us from Pennsylvania. And he's going to be sharing on the economics of the kingdom of God. So before we get started, let's just bow our heads for a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. We praise your name for your goodness and your patience with us. We thank you that we are gathered here with these brothers from all over the globe to learn truth, to hear a word from you. We pray that you would be with Brother Edsel this morning as he shares what you've laid on his heart. I pray that it would be edifying to each one of us. Prepare our hearts to receive the truth and to learn from it and to make changes in our lives according to the teaching of the Holy Spirit. Pray that your Spirit would be present this morning in each one of our hearts and with Brother Edsel as he shares. Give him clarity of thought. And I pray that your name would be glorified in everything that is said. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. After
I hope to share with you this morning in 45 minutes a topic that normally I take four sessions in, the economics of the kingdom of God. And I guess first thing I should do is define what we mean by economics. And just a general, let's say, schoolboy kind of definition is economics concerns itself with the production, distribution, and consumption of goods and services. And so we're talking about something here that's very material. But like in every part, aspect of our life, the kingdom of God impinges upon this. It has something to say about how we conduct our economic lives and how we interact with people in that realm, because it is a very important way in which we interact. I would say many of us, for example, have a tendency to define ourselves by our work. What do we do? Often that is a topic of conversation. Well, what's your work? What do you do? And that helps to define us and so on. Today, I'm going to look at, first of all, economics under the Old Testament covenant. And then I want to move from there and look at Jesus's teaching on economics. And then I want to look at the New Testament, the early churches, the New Testament churches practice of the principles of the economics of the kingdom of God. And I want to underline basic principles that I go across the whole thing, whether it's in the Old Testament or whether it's in what Jesus is talking about, and whether it's how the first church, the early church, defined or actually worked it out. Now there are different situations and different contexts and so on like that, but I find these four principles being pretty universal when we talk about the economics of the kingdom of God. First of all is the idea of equality, economic equality. And then the idea of every man working for his own living, an open hand to the poor, and the redistribution of wealth. Those four points: equality, every man working for his own living, an open hand to the poor, and redistribution of wealth. Okay, now let's then just move right in and look at the economics of the under the old covenant. When in the Garden of Eden, when God made Adam and Eve, he gave them a commission. He gave them a task. He said that they were to be fruitful and to multiply, and they were to exercise dominion over the earth. Later on, he gave them in little shortly after that, he gave placed them in a garden, and he said that they were to tend that garden. So already we see that there's work to be done, even in the perfection of the first creation before sin entered into the world. There is an economic system being placed in, being put in place. And of course, that continues on even after the fall. But of course, our economic understanding is also marred. Economic pursuits are marred by the sin that comes into the world through the fall. And then if we go to the Ten Commandments, which is kind of a summation of the ethical aspects of God's covenant with Israel that Moses, that God gave through Moses, there are two commandments that actually have to do with economics. And one of them is the commandment, don't steal, don't take other people's possessions. And the other one is you shall not covet, okay? So we have two, you shouldn't desire or want to covet. And of course, there is talking about a man's wife, but also is our, the rest of us largely talking about man's, another person's possessions. Now, one of the things about coveting, which I think is really interesting when we talk about that, you know, we look at stealing, well, we know what stealing is. It's an actual taking of something away from somebody. When you talk about coveting, well, what's that? Well, coveting has to do with a desire. Coveting has to do with wanting something. And it often leads to actions. It often leads to doing some things. But I think we've had a tendency when we look at the whole idea of coveting make it something that's entirely interior. Deal with the aspect more the objective reality of coveting. And so what's it mean to covet? Is it just simply something interior, or is it also something you do? And I'd like to suggest to us this morning that it's not just simply interior. It begins there, just as the decision to steal something begins inside you. It's an interior thing, but then it's worked out in an action. And I'd like to suggest the same thing with coveting. But I think we've had a tendency to make it very interior justify doing some things that maybe we shouldn't be doing by saying, well, you know, in my heart, I don't feel this way. So let's then look at God's provision for Israel. When he brought them into the promised land after the conquest of Canaan, he distributed the land among the tribes, and he gave an inheritance according to those who were numbered with them. And so there we have, I think, the principle of equality. Some of the tribes were larger than others. Some of the territory that they took was more productive than others. And there seems to be a kind of a rough equality there, where the land was divided out according to the size of the tribe and according to the quality of land that they were given. He promised them that if they observe, as it says in Leviticus 25:17, so you shall observe my statutes and keep my judgments and perform them, and you will dwell in the land in safety. Then the land will yield its fruit, and you will eat your fill and dwell there in safety. Leviticus 25 is actually a very, very important chapter when it deals with God's laws, what deals with his rules for how they were to operate economically. It's a very key passage for how they're supposed to treat each other when it comes to the field of when it comes to the area of economics and what the consequences of that would be. And so I just want to look at that. There's also Deuteronomy 15 is also an important passage when we're looking here at the Old Covenant, Old Testament law. One of the things that I noticed, so we have this distribution of the land. And one of the things we have to keep in mind is that let's say 150 years ago, maybe longer now, maybe we're getting close to 200 years, all economies were agriculturally based. Our economy, agriculture is an important sector, but we're not an agriculturally based economy. We used to be an industrially based economy. I'm not sure if we're that anymore. And so on. It's much more mixed than that. I mean, agriculture is an important part, but before, say, 200 years ago, the economy was based on agriculture. Most people were, in some ways or another, involved in agriculture. And it was this way and under the old covenant. And so having land is very important. And so we see in this parceling out the land that each person has their own land. It's the idea is, as one of the prophets say, every man under his own vine and fig tree, living in peace and unafraid. That's the old covenant idea. In a sense, if we want to talk about in economic terms, the land is the basic capital. And in a sense, God wants to each person to have the basic capital they need to provide a living for their family. But one of the things that we notice is that this gets out of whack. There's a number of reasons why it does. Some people are just better workers and better managers than others. There are misfortunes that come around. Bad health, maybe not enough sons to help do the farm work and stuff like that. Maybe the person is not that good of a manager or whatever. Maybe they're slothful and so on. And so you have a tendency for this idea that God has to get kind of out of balance. And so what we see is a periodic readjustment being put in place so that, again, we're not having the development of an agricultural-based society in which a few men really manage to get a hold of all the capital, all the land. So every 7 years we have on a Sabbath kind of Sabbath, and then every 49 years we have a readjustment. And there are some principles along with this. One is that they were not to oppress each other, and they were to have a wide open hand to the poor. And then we have the law of lending. Once you lend somebody something, there was the thing like if you took a man's cloak, you had to bring it back and give it back to him in the evening. I think if anybody actually did this, it would have been a very inconvenient way of loaning something. If you took a person's coat for security or whatever, most people I have a feeling wouldn't be bothered. So, and then also there's the provision against usury, of not charging interest, and so on. And then there's the law of gleaning. If a person had lost his land and so on and needed a way to simply provide food for himself, there's the law of gleaning, which they could go into neighboring fields. And the instruction was given that you were not to harvest the corners and you were not to pick up the dropped sheaves, but those were for persons to come and glean. So there's the idea of, yes, a provision being made, but one person has to work, okay? It's not just handed over to them. And then there's the law of redemption. And that is the idea that the land, and that was based on the premise that the land does not belong to the persons. It's given to them, in a sense, loaned to them by God. All the land ultimately belongs to God. And if somebody, because whatever reason, lose possession of the land, it was to be returned to them after a period of time. And since if you bought land, what you were actually buying was the use of the land for a period of time, and eventually it would go back to whose inheritance it was. There, and similar to the law of servitude, you could, in a sense, purchase the labor for a period of time of a person who was then, in a sense, he was your slave, but it was a temporary enslavement. And then we have the idea of the kinsman redeemer, where a kinsman could come, a relative of yours could come, and it could pay, you know, pay the money back and have the land redeemed, or pay the money to have the person released from their servitude and so on. And then we have these years of release, the Sabbath year, which brought to an end, the servitude, and then the year of Jubilee, where everything was readjusted, every 49 years, everything was readjusted, and we got kind of go back to base one again. Now, the question is, how much did Israel obey this? Well, we don't actually know. So there's some indication that they may have obeyed parts and pieces of it at periods of time. It seems like particularly during the years of the kingdom of Israel, that this became was not really practiced very much. In fact, one of the things that God had warned them through Samuel is, if you have a king, you're going to see these inequalities arise and in the land, and that is what we had. And the prophets weigh in against this, particularly against the kind of oppression that arises with these inequalities. Isaiah talks about castigates the rulers and the elite of Israel for eating the plunder of the poor. And Amos talks about, for three transgressions, for four, I will not turn away the punishment. And if you look at those, most of those have to do with how with the whole realm of economics, oppressing the poor, adding land to land, and so on like that. So part of the judgment that comes upon Israel, it's not entirely because idolatry is involved there, immorality is involved there, but the the rise of economic equality, economic oppression, is one of the major reasons why God brings judgment upon Israel. Okay, so that's in some kind of the Old Testament provision and the whole way the economic system is supposed to work under the Old Covenant. Again, it's the idea, the four principles of equality, every man working for his own living, an open hand to the poor, and then the redistribution or readjustment of wealth. So that takes us then to the teachings of Jesus, and then also how it was worked out with the apostles. And I think one of the things we think about when we talk about the economics of the kingdom is we have to ask ourselves, well, what is the nature of the kingdom of God? And this is how I talk about it. The kingdom is made up of people who acknowledge a king. And our king is Jesus. And one of the things I note is that God has always had a people under the Testament. It was Israel, it was a nation state, it was tied to a particular geographic area, at least after their coming into the promised land. There was, from Dan to Beersheba was the land. There was a law written on tables of stone, a civil call, that had a civil code with persons who enforced the law, and there was a ruler. Now, initially it was supposed to be God, but Israel rejected that idea for an earthly king, all right? Now, under the New Testament, we have a spiritual kingdom. Now, when I say we have a spiritual kingdom, I'm not saying that it's just simply what's in people's hearts and it's invisible or anything. It's actually visible, okay? The kingdom of God is visible, but it's not tied to a particular piece of land as it was under the Old Covenant. Who belongs to is not determined by physical birth, as it was under Israel, but by a spiritual birth. It's God's people who are called out from every tongue, kindred, tribe, and nation. It's voluntary. The law is written on the heart, and the Holy Spirit is the enforcer. The ruler is Jesus. He's the Lamb who has taken, Lamb of God, who has taken away the sins of the world, and he's the word of God, sharper and more powerful than any two-edged sword. So when we speak of the economics of the kingdom, we have to keep these realities in mind. So let's look then at Jesus's teaching on economics. And I'm going to do this by basically doing a quick survey of the Gospel of Luke. The gospel, one of the themes in the Gospel of Luke has to do with Jesus's critique of riches and Jesus' critique of the economic system, which has gotten out of whack and oppresses people. And in Luke 1:53, when Mary talks about the fact of what God is doing, so he said he has filled the hungry with good things and the rich he has sent away empty. And so we have this idea that those who have will have it taken away from them, and and those who haven't will be given to it. And why? I mean, that doesn't quite seem fair, does it? But what Jesus is talking about is that often those who have it because they've been oppressive, or they have ignored the principles of the economics of the kingdom of God. And one of the things that we do notice is in Luke chapter 4, when Jesus is in Nazareth and they open up he's there in the synagogue on the Sabbath, and they hand him the scroll and he opens it up to Isaiah. And one of the things that he says is that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. And he says at that particular point that this prophecy is being fulfilled here in your hearing. One of the other things that we notice in the Gospel of Luke is the blessings and the woes. And if we go to Luke chapter 6, on the Sermon on the Plain, which is not exactly the same as the Sermon on the Mount, there's similar material. Jesus, I think, is like what was like any preacher who uses the same material over again and preaches the same sermon a number of different places and times, maybe tweaking it here a bit, making it apply in a particular context and situation here. And so I think that's important to keep in mind. So in Luke 24:25, Jesus says to them, "Woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you for who are full, for you will hunger." Now the question is, who are the poor and who are the rich? I think that one of the things, just like with coveting, I think that this is one of the things that we really like to relativize, and it is relative. It is relative, but I think sometimes we have a tendency to talk about, do relativize it to a point where it really defangs the whole thing. It takes any of the oomph out of what Jesus is saying. One of the things I think about is, in our context, what do we mean when we say he's a rich man? Or what do we mean when we say they're poor? We probably don't mean the same thing that they mean, in some third world country. In every country they have rich people and they have poor people. Here in America, we probably don't mean exactly the same thing they do in a third world poor, but it does mean the same to us. I do remember back in the Depression, Will Rogers says that America is the only country that goes to the poorhouse in an automobile. There are, in a sense, it's relative, but those kinds of ways of talking do mean something. And I think that one of the things that we have to keep in mind is that if we start at that level, if we in a sense work from that, we can say, well, we do have some understanding of what it means to be rich and what it means to be poor. Now, one of the things you'll notice in Luke chapter 6, verse 38, is this principle of an open hand to the poor. Jesus says, "Give, and it will be given to you. And good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put in your bosom. For with the same measure you use it, it will be measured back to you." So we have this idea of generosity, of having an open hand to the poor. But also Jesus talks about the deceitfulness of riches. In the parable of the sower, he talks about, in Luke chapter 8, he talks about the ones that fell among the thorns are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, with riches and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity. So riches are something that can choke out our relationship with God. And they often do. If we pursue that, that's going to be a thing. And then in Luke chapter 11, verse 3, Jesus teaches us in the Lord's Prayer. He says one of the petitions we're to give is to give us this day our daily bread. And so there's this idea of trusting in God for our economic security. Lord, give us our daily bread. There we have the idea of not laying up treasures, but asking God for what we need right now. Then in Luke chapter 12, we have a warning against covetousness. And again, what is it? It's an eagerness for gain, a desiring for more, wanting a greater share. And why do we want more? What is the motivation? I think oftentimes the motivation is security. We feel so if we lay up enough that we'll have security. Sometimes people are covetous because they want power. They want the power that comes with it. And you know, we can certainly see in our society today, there are people who have amassed huge sums of money. And they then therefore assume because of that economic power that they have, that people should listen to them. And I think this goes on in a smaller way, even in our own communities, where people who are well off and who have more economic means really do expect that that's kind of a marker of success. It's a marker of perhaps good management. It's a marker of maybe some better wisdom or whatever. And so they often expect to be paid attention to and to be listened to. And I think it's often we often do. And we have this this idea of in Luke about the story about the parable that Jesus told about the person who is wanting to build a bigger barn. And and the idea is, you know, I've done this, I'm going to take my ease and so on after having amassed this huge amount of sum. And what does Jesus say? He says to them that you're full. Okay. He says, full, this night your soul will be required of you. And then whose will these things be which you have provided? One of the things I'm really kind of struck by is how many times we see somebody amassing a huge sum of money and they die. And there is that pile. And then what do their heirs do with it? Do they even use it in the way that person would want to see? Now, Jesus, one of the things that I talked about is that Jesus is saying one of the things that I talked about why people amass large sums has to do with security. And I just want to remind us what Jesus said. He says, and Luke, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, nor about the body, what you will put on. Life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have neither storehouse nor barn, and God feeds them. Or how much more value are than the birds? And which of you by worrying could add one cubit to his stature? If you then are not able to do the least, why are you anxious for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I say to you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothes the grass, which today is in the field and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? And do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. For all these things the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows that you need these things. Okay, so what are we supposed to do instead? Well, Jesus says we're to seek the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you. Do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So sell what you have, give alms, provide yourself money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches nor moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So I just want you to notice the three things that Jesus says here we're to do. Instead of piling piles up, we're to seek the kingdom of God, we're to give alms, and we're to provide a treasure in heaven. And I want you to note here, Jesus says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Not where your heart is, there is your treasure. And again, I think we try to try to flip this around. Oftentimes said, well, you know, I have this big power, my heart's really not in it, and so on. My heart's really with the Lord and so on. Well, Jesus is very clear. He says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. But we want to flip that and say, where your heart is, so there your treasure is, and we make an interior. And one of the things I think that sometimes we have to keep in mind is that the fact that Jesus is trying to address the heart issue and so on can sometimes be corrupted, or can sometimes be misunderstood to think, well, it's just simply a matter of the heart and what I do doesn't matter, or, you know, really what matters is what's in my heart. I think what Jesus came to do is to line up our hearts so that we do, that our hearts are right, but also that it results in us doing what is acceptable to him and pleasing to him, and living in a just and equitable way in our world around us. So Jesus told us this story we have this incident in Luke chapter 16, where Jesus I'm running ahead of myself here. We do have this. This is a story in Luke chapter 16, 1 to 18. Chapter 18 is when we get to this story. There's a certain rich man who had a steward, and an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his good. So he called him and said to him, "What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be a steward." Then the steward said within himself, "What should I do? For my master is taking the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig. I'm ashamed to beg. I resolved to do. When I put out a stewardship, that they may receive me into their houses." So he called every one of his master's debtors to him and said to him first, "How much do you owe your master?" And so he goes through thing and he cuts the thing down. And Jesus says here, "So the master condemned the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light. And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into everlasting home. He who is faithful in what is least is also faithful much, and he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you've not been faithful in what another man's, who will give you what is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." Now, you know, the story that Jesus tells is an interesting story. And like one of the things we have to keep in mind about parables is that the story, it's not necessarily an allegory, in which every part of the story has some meaning and so on. Sometimes the story is just, the story is there, and the details are kind of to flesh out the story to make the story work. But there's one basic point Jesus is trying to make. And that is that when it comes to our economic affairs, we should think about, are we conducting our lives in such a way that we are making friends for ourselves with our unrighteous mammon? Okay. I think oftentimes of the impact that generosity can have in people's lives when they're recipients of generosity from our church communities and so on, that's from things like CAM. What kind of impact does that have? How does that open up people's receptiveness to the gospel and to what we have to say? And so in that sense, we can use this unrighteous mammon to buy friends for ourselves, all right? And Jesus says, if you use this quote unquote unrighteous mammon, this money you have, these riches and so on, for my kingdom, then if you use it in the way that I intended you to use it, all right, then more will be given to you, all right? Sometimes I wonder, is the lack of spiritual vitality and so on in our communities, is it because we're piling too much up for ourselves and we're not using it in the way God wants us to use it? We do have some economic power. How are we using it? And I think it's a very important thing. But Jesus says here that you cannot serve two masters. You'll be loyal to one, you'll despise the other. You can't serve God and mammon. And so how is it determined which one you serve? Well, it's determined by how you use the unrighteous mammon that's been in your possession. Are we using it to secure our heavenly home? And if you use it for other purposes, how will God give you the true riches? Now, then we go to Luke chapter 18, the story of the rich young ruler. I'm not going to read through it. I think the story is very well known to us. But this young man comes and he wants eternal life. And Jesus tells him, well, you should sell all you have and give it to the poor and come follow me. And the young man couldn't handle that one. He turned away. He became very sorrowful because he was very rich. This would be an incredible sacrifice for him. And Jesus says to his disciples, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Now, you know, probably you have all read here that with Jesus, there's this place in Jerusalem, which is a little low door, and they call it the eye of the needle. It's in a wall. And for a camel to get through it, he has to unload itself, hunker down, and sort of scrooge into it, and so on. And this is what Jesus is talking about. That's an invention. There may be a door or entryway into a wall there in Jerusalem. But my understanding is that is a wall that was built like in the Middle Ages and wasn't around when Jesus was around, and probably something that some Arab guide told somebody in the 19th century when Europeans were starting to tour around in the Holy Land, and it got put in somebody's commentary. I think Jesus is talking here about, you know, the comparison he's making is to a sewing needle and a camel. You can't get them through. It's impossible. Well, disciples say, well, then who can be saved? And Jesus says the things which are possible with men are possible with God. And I think he's talking here about the fact that it is possible for a rich young ruler to, this young man did not, but it is possible for a rich young ruler to obey what Jesus has to say and to give up everything and come follow him. And the disciples said, well, Lord, we've left all and followed you. And Jesus said, assuredly, I say to you that no one has left houses or parents or brothers or wives or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who shall not receive many times more in this present age and in the age to come. All right. Now, one of the things I think also that we want to do with this passage is say, well, this is what this rich young ruler's problem was, and so it's not a universal application. Well, Jesus does make it universal when he says that it's impossible for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. He wasn't just talking about this young man, all right? He was talking about rich in general, and it's a very sobering warning for us, all right? Now, in Luke 21, 1-4, Jesus says, when he saw it's another instant in which he looked up and saw the rich putting their gifts in the treasury there in the temple, and he also saw a certain poor widow putting in two mites. So he said, truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all, for all these out of their abundance have put in offerings for God, but she out of her poverty put in all the livelihood that she had. And one of the things I hear people say, well, if we don't have rich people, how are we going to get done the things that we need done? They're the ones who actually provide the money. Well, I think Jesus is telling us here that, you know, he can do more with this widow's poor two mites than he can do with the riches with the riches of rich people, with what the rich people put in. So I don't think that Jesus is really dependent upon the rich to get his work done, to, in a sense, to subsidize it or to finance it. Okay, so that's the teaching. Jesus is teaching in the Gospel of Luke. Let's then look at the practice of the early church. In Acts 2, 46, and in Acts 4, 33, 37, we have, after the preaching of the gospel and people being baptized and so on, it says that not all who believed were together and had all things in common and sold their possessions and good and divided them among all as anyone had need. a similar thing is said in Luke 4. I mean, excuse me, Acts 4. One of the things I want you to notice, what I want you to notice here is they sold their possessions and goods. They divided them as they had, as any had need, and they did it voluntarily. Now, one of the things that's interesting is that people say, well, you know, this was not continued on, this practice here. Well, that's because when they look at this word, have all things in common, people almost immediately begin to think of something like the Hutterites, who live together in a community where the means of production are managed by the community as well as the consumption. So you have production and consumption all being communal. And so they don't see that continuing on in the early church. And so they say, well, this is just something for this particular period. But I'd like to argue that's not what is happening here, and that what is happening here is actually something that did continue on in the early church and other places. All right. I don't think that we're having a communal society here in which the means of production are controlled, and as well as the means of distribution. But what we have here is a voluntary selling of possessions and goods, and dividing them to those who had need. And I think that when it talks about those who had lands or houses sold them, I don't think that Jesus, that what we have here is people selling out the houses the house that they live in, or the land that they're making their living from, but they're getting rid of their extra stuff. They're getting rid of other houses that they might have, or more land than the land that they don't actually need to provide for their living. And so they're getting rid of that. They're selling it, and they're using the proceeds for the kingdom of God. Again, it's kind of the idea. Well, what are you doing? You're getting rid of your excess. You're redistributing it to those who have need. All right. Now, the reason why I think that this is an ongoing practice is because we see it in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, in which Paul is given instructions about the collection that's supposed to be taken up. For the poor in Jerusalem, they've had a famine. And he gives them instructions that they are to prepare this gift. But this is what he says. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that as you have all sufficiency and all things, may have an abundance for every good work. That's my friend John D. Martin's favorite passage, but I want you to notice that this passage is in the context of our generosity toward others. As it is written, he is dispersed abroad, he is given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for the food supply and multiply the seed you have sown, increase the fruits of your righteousness, while you're enriched in everything for all liberality, which causes thanksgiving through us to God, and for the administration of the service not only supplies the needs of the saint, but is also abounding through many thanksgiving. Well, through the proof of this ministry, they glorify God for the obedience of your confession to the gospel of Christ, and for your liberal sharing with them and all men, and by their prayer for you, who long for you because of the exceeding grace of God in you. Thanks be to God for this indescribable gift. So the thing I want you to notice here is the kingdom of God is for the poor. The rich can hardly enter it except they give up their riches. Covetousness, accumulating stores, is foolish. God expects us to be generous. God expects us to trust in him. We should have the good sense to use our riches for our spiritual benefit. God doesn't need the rich to get his kingdom work done. God calls his people to hold all things in common, which they don't say, this is mine. It's something I can clutch to myself, but it's actually thing. It's what I have is to be used to help others. And there's a redistribution. Here we see again, a redistribution. And Paul says that he doesn't want you not to have enough. But again, it's kind of that idea in Proverbs where it says, you know, Lord, don't make me rich that I forget you. Don't make me poor that I curse you, but just give me enough. That's kind of the idea that we have here. All right. That's what I have to share for this morning.
Thank you, brother.
Did I stay in my time?
Yeah, you did very well. Thank you for condensing those four talks into one talk this morning. I think there's a lot there, and you covered a lot of ground. So God bless you for that. I think we'd have done well to stretch this into four different talks just to get to.
That would have meant I would have had to get up four mornings, Saturday mornings.
Oh yeah.
Well, that would have really stretched me.
It would have. There is a week.
The nice
break
thing is, if I ever want to listen to any of these things, I can always go online and listen to them.
That's true.
I have on occasion done that.
Yeah.
I guess
there's a week break in between, so you could have got a week of rest in between.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for packing it in here this morning. I know I have a list of questions, so we're going to open it up for questions and discussion this morning. So have your questions ready. It's obvious that this doesn't just impact every aspect of our lives, but it also impacts our perception of God and so many little details of how we view the things that we have and how we handle them and our relationships with each other. And so it is quite something. And something that has blessed me numerous times in thinking about this topic, and that is the care God has for the poor. Mm-hmm. All the way through the Old Testament, his provisions in the Old Covenant for the poor. I mean, it really, really shows the heart of God for those who just don't have as much, I guess, and are more dependent on him. I think it's a dependency thing as well with that. One question I have is, how would you define stewardship in light of kingdom economics? The reason I ask that is we've heard a lot about stewardship. But sometimes to me, it almost seems like it becomes, anyway, I'll let you answer that question.
Well, I think that stewardship has the idea of being careful,
right?
With what you have, using it carefully. And I think that's a good thing to keep in mind, that we are to use our economic means and our economic power in a careful way. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not to waste it foolishly. And I think that has the idea that, you know, that we're not spending a lot of stuff, a lot of unnecessary stuff on ourselves. We're not raising our standard of living and so on. It has that idea to it. I think, you know, like any good idea, people can do curious and wicked things with it. Sometimes it can be used in a backhanded way as a justification for what I think amounts to simply selfishness. And also the idea that, you know, it could add as a justification for accumulating, which Jesus tells us we're not supposed to do. So I think that stewardship is a good thing. But part of stewardship is using the resources God has given us. And this is the thing we have to always keep in mind. When we talk about stewardship, we're talking about taking care of something that God has given us. But, you know, one of the main things that Jesus says, and I forgot to mention that Paul talks about two reasons why, that he says you're to work for your living. Okay. And the two reasons are is to provide for yourself and to give to the poor. All right. That's stewardship, to provide for yourself, for your basic needs, and a reasonable level of comfort, I think, and to give to the poor. Those are the two reasons. That's stewardship.
Thank you. I think we've all seen where stewardship, well, it's just good stewardship. You know, you've heard that slapped on a lot of things that ended up being other things, selfish reasons for doing what they're doing. There's something you touched on there that in that answer that I've been amazed at is how we naturally increase our level of living based on, you know, how well we're doing, I guess. Standard of living tends to creep up with the income increase, or if as times get better, it seems like the standard of living creeps up. And the real challenge is to keep the standard of living you know, as if, you know, nothing has changed. And I've been blessed by John Wesley's life, where he set his income at X amount of dollars, regardless of how well he was doing. And the rest of it just meant that, well, he had more to give if it was over and above that. Is a good example. So any of you have questions or comments for Brother Edsel? Maybe while you're thinking about that, there's a question a brother had shared with me about a year ago, I would say. And he just said, you know, Jesus says, don't lay up treasure on earth, but lay up treasure in heaven. How do we lay up treasure in heaven?
Well, I think that in the context of the passage there, that it has to do with giving alms. It has to be with being generous to the poor, to those who are in need. That's how we lay up treasures in heaven. That's the context of it. And so that's, I think, what we have to do. We have to have that open hand to the poor, to those who are in need. You know, I think, to me, one of the things, you know, that, we have really actually good mechanisms to do that. We have CAM. I mean, we can just give more money to CAM. They're doing a good work. They're helping the poor. They're helping those who are hungry. We just give more money. And you know, a lot of money goes through there, but there's still lots more that we could be doing. And I think about that. How much more could we be reducing our consumption on ourselves, our standard of living, to help those who don't even have some of the basic necessities of life. So I think that's one thing. The other thing, though, I think is that we need to be personally open to circumstances and to things. A number of years ago, Vince and I shared one of my messages that was really a real turning point. Is when I was 19 years old, I was in England for a study semester abroad. I had gone to a large church that Sunday morning, and I came out, and there were all these beggars around at the outside the church. And I know they were there. They thought, well, these people coming out of church are going to be a soft touch. And so I had this one man come up to me. He was kind of a middle-aged man. He was a bum, essentially. He's probably a rummy, an alcoholic or whatever. And he asked me, can you give me 50 bob, please? And I said, no. I just turned him aside and started walking down the street, a sidewalk. And he started following me, and he started cursing me and so on. And I felt it was a fearful thing. I was, what's this man going to do to me? But I also felt convicted. I didn't do what Jesus told me to do, which was I should have given him something. Now, of course, we get into the whole thing, well, what are they going to do with it? You know, well, maybe he'll just go buy some booze, or maybe he'll go buy some cocaine. He's not going to use it in a right way. And so, but, you know, I'm not responsible for what people do with my generosity. Mm-hmm. And if you think about it, if Jesus husband everything up, if he's always asking himself, well, what are they going to do with what I give them? Okay, well, the fact of the matter is that most people do not misuse what God has given them. He paid the price for our sins. Most people simply reject that. Did that keep him from coming and doing it? No, it didn't. And so the burden, we cannot control that. I had a friend when we lived in Philadelphia. There was a man on our street who, he was an alcoholic and so on. And he came to my friend and he said, would you give me some money? I need to buy some groceries and so on. And my friend said, well, I'm not going to give you money, but I will give you some groceries. And so he took him to the grocery store. They got a couple bags of groceries and so on, went back home and so on. And later that day, my friend saw this man carrying these two bags of groceries over to the local bar and exchanging them for some booze. Okay. Well, he tried to control the situation. We just have to accept the fact that in the end, we can't control. Okay. But if we are we going to say we can't control it, and as a consequence, you know, we're not going to be generous. I remember my father-in-law saying to me a number of years ago, this is like 25 years ago, he's still living. My father-in-law was not Mennonite, but he had heard that, you know, that, and I don't know if it was true or not, but he had heard that some of MCC's canned meat had gotten to the North Korean army and they were eating this canned meat. He just thought this was an awful thing. And I thought, well, it got there somehow or another, you know, that's probably not where it was meant to go. But does that mean that MCC was supposed to stop distributing canned meat to people that they thought needed it? Okay. And so, no, it doesn't. So we aren't going to be able to control it, everything. Now, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be careful and think about, you know, we do want to be maximized in everything as much as we can. But we can't control what people do with our generosity. But that can't stop us from being generous.
Amen.
And so now, when I go someplace, I don't carry a lot of cash on me. But like when I go to Washington, D.C. or something like that, there's always people there begging. I give them something. Mm-hmm. And you know what? They almost always say to me, God bless you. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I have to keep in mind, particularly when I see some of those beggars, probably most of them are mentally ill. They are the poor. They've probably had experiences in their life that have not been good. And if somehow or another, my giving them a couple bucks is a means by which they think somebody cares about them, God loves them. And they always say, God bless you. And I do feel blessed when I do that. And I feel like I'm doing God's will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. I feel like in my own experience, if I've held back, if I drill down on it, it's usually a place of self-righteousness or where I've elevated myself in a position of, you know, I have it, so I'm going to be careful how I give it to you. And so I can pass a judgment on your life. Are you going to use it properly? Instead of just a humble servant attitude that what I have is God's and he's asked me to give it to the poor, and to have more of a tendency to give than to hold on to it. I dropped some money into a cup here a few days ago, and I said that Jesus Christ loves him. And he looked at me with a huge smile and he says, and he loves you too. And it was actually quite a blessing.
Yeah.
Any of you brothers have, go ahead, Brother Bryant.
Thank you, Brother Edsel, for taking us on this journey through scripture this morning. I find it inspiring and challenging. And it's so amazing the difference between somebody with a scarcity mindset and an abundance mindset. Mm-hmm. And I think as followers of Jesus, I mean, that people should just know us as somebody who just has this abundance mindset. Like, you know, Jesus Christ is our King, and he's in control of everything. And he loves a cheerful giver. Mm-hmm. Freely you have received, freely give. And I think all of us know of people who've been around who just have that mentality, and it's really inspiring. Mm-hmm. But I just have I wrestle though with several things in this whole conversation, and that is, so it can be easy, you know, to just kind of give our money to Cam, mm-hmm. As you suggested, maybe as a way, and I think that can be a good way. Can that be like an abdication of responsibility when it comes to really, I think God is calling us to steward our resources first locally, right? So within a brotherhood, mm-hmm. do good to others, especially those in the household of faith. And then discussing that, So household of faith, and then even local, you begin to realize then too, there's these chronic poverty issues where there's just been generations of dependency. So there's chronic poverty. Of course, there's critical too. Someone has a fire, you know, they need a shelter. So you kind of have the critical issues, which are pretty easy, but then you have the chronic issues. And I think, isn't it sometimes those are some of the hardest things to respond to and to know how to help. And money, just throwing money at the city at a chronic need is not going to help that situation. And I think about how so many of us are so greedy with our time. Sometimes we use the word time as money. So is there something like in the economics of the kingdom of God of thinking of just your time as money? I don't know. I'm thinking out loud here with.
What you're talking about is, I think what you're talking about is, you know, what sometimes we talk about investing ourselves in people's lives. One of the things I do think we often have to think is that how much we are the recipients of other people's generosity. You know, the fact of the matter that you may have been raised in a home where you were taught to work, you were taught to be careful, and so on. You didn't, you were, in a sense, you were given these things, and they have stood you in good stead, and you want to pass them on to, you know, your children or the people around you. There are some people for whom that was not the case. And so there we talk, that is what we sometimes refer to as social capital. And if you have a lot of social capital that stands you in good stead, may even be very, it's often very helpful to for the accumulation of economic capital. And so what do you do when you're working with some people who don't have a lot of social capital? And it results sometimes in them not having the, you know, not economically being in a stable situation and so on. Well, you're dealing with what you call chronic, and then you deal with what's acute. Chronic is, you know, the immediate need needs to be addressed. You know, if they don't have enough to live on, if they don't have enough food, if they whatever, then somehow or another that needs to be addressed. But then you also need to move into giving in them sense that social capital or those personal resources so that they can actually become somewhat self-sufficient. And that involves teaching. And, you know, and again, if we think about CAM, one of the things that CAM has moved into is from quote unquote relief, addressing immediate acute situations, to more development kind of things. That's a very common thing that all aid organizations eventually, they start out as relief organizations addressing acute issues and then dealing then with more structural issues. Trying to, in a sense, equip people to provide for themselves. And that's what we have to do. CAM does it on like an institutional kind of way, but we also need to, when the people that we're working with, that we're encountering and so on, we need to help them with that too. And that does take time, and it doesn't always work. Because your people, sometimes, even though they don't have, they're still not willing to learn, or maybe their feelings. None of us really like to be corrected. That's not a pleasant experience. So sometimes it doesn't work. But still, Jesus calls us to do that. But certainly, like on the local level, I mean, I would say that, you know, primarily, as far as, you know, when I think about our congregation in the resources we have, Much of our sharing is done very much on a local level. One of the things that we, and I imagine many of your congregations are this way too, but one of the things that we do assume is that, you know, we are going to help each other with with medical bills. And I would say over the course of our congregation's history that we have we have spent more money on medical bills than on any other item over the years. They're expensive and it's very hard for people to handle them on their own. And so on. And it's worked. We've always been able to, and we've paid some fairly ferocious large medical bills, and we've always been able to do that. And God has blessed us. But, you know, in the end, none of us have enough, we don't have enough resources to cover every contingency. Our first bishop, Lynn Martin, used to say, we don't have enough to take care of everything. In the end, we are going to have to rely on God and trust in Him. And I think if we are obedient to what God has said, that He has said, you know, I will take care of you. Now that's not the same thing as the prosperity gospel that's being really touted in many places. One of the things that's interesting to me is how prevalent the prosperity gospel is in places like Africa, where people don't have a lot, and I always wonder how that really works. I have a feeling that, but nonetheless, it's very, very popular. So go ahead. I'm not sure if that really addresses what you're talking about. But yes, investing ourselves in people's lives is very important in helping them to become, in a sense, self-sufficient, in a sense of being able to manage their own lives in a good way, I think is the task that's before us.
Sure. Thank you for sharing that. You know, as largely Anabaptists have incredible economic means, and it's because we're hardworking. And what if we would, you know, and I think sometimes it's, we feel like we're driven. We have to have, you know, this big of a property. We have to have this. We have to have, you know, all these things. And that scarcity mindset, that fearful mindset that we've allowed the world to give us, then limits us in how much we can actually serve those around us, where if we would take, you know, a little bit of risk, it's amazing maybe how God could provide for us and how much more we could do at a local level. Thanks for sharing. Yeah.
That is a thought that I had in regards to this, and you touched on it there, Ed. Maybe we should be quicker to realize that we need to rely on God. Jesus brought that out in Matthew when he said, consider the lilies. Let's remember who we serve and who holds all things in the choices we make in regards to this, to giving and to investing in the kingdom, or investing in our laying up treasure in heaven, which is another way of investing in heaven, basically, making sure that that's where our installments are going. It's helped me to think about that in regards to every aspect of life. How does this invest in the kingdom of heaven? How does this purchase going to invest? What is the interest I'm going to gain on this? Is it here in this world now for myself, or is it in the kingdom of heaven? Mm-hmm. Does someone else have any comments or questions? We're coming to the end of our time here, or at it.
Can I ask a question?
Go ahead.
Edsel, can you explain?
Yes, Patrick. Hello.
I was trying to hide. Can you talk about the investment that the churches in Chambersburg are making in the room quickly?
Oh, yeah. Well, one of the things I'm involved in is the thing we call it the room, and we use the basement of Chambersburg Christian Fellowship, and it's a very simple kind of thing. Tuesdays and Fridays, we open around 4:30. It's a place for people to come and sit and be safe. We have coffee and tea, and then there's a meal, there's a short devotion, and so on like that. And it's just really... I would say basically it's a place where we can can show people the love of Christ. And most of the people who come, I would say, are people that are on the margins of economically, lots of people who have mental health issues and so on. So that's been, I got involved. I mean, we helped out, you know, on an occasional basis before, but about 2 years ago, I got involved in a more concrete way and a regular way, going in on Fridays. And I think, you know, I don't know, have we seen anybody converted? I'm not sure there. But one of the things I was struck about was a discussion we had about a year ago, what's the purpose of it? And the overall thing is that we weren't going to look at results. We weren't going to be result-oriented. We're talking about here, what's our purpose? And the purpose is to show the love of Christ to these people. And I think it's been very good for us. I'm really blessed by it. We have a group of young people who are helping with it. This started out as a ministry of Shippensburg and Chambersburg and St. Thomas Christian Fellowship, but now we have people involved from other Mennonite churches in our area who are really who are helping out and coming in and, you know, providing meals and stuff like that. In that sense, it's been a real, you know, we have umpteen different kinds of plain people in this valley. And, you know, this has been kind of an interesting place of intersection and cooperation in an unofficial kind of way, which has really been a blessing. I don't know if that's enough, Patrick. And I would say it is very much, which is close to Patrick's heart, a Matthew 25 ministry. So,
now, I'm mostly what I was thinking is you were talking about doing things without expecting results.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a practical example of it in our little community. Because I remember having conversations with people and they said, where are the results? And I remember at one of the first board meetings with Shippensburg, and I said, the results are in us by doing it daily. Yeah. And not getting anything. So that's the only reason I brought that up.
Yeah.
I think that's a good point. The fruit is in your lives for your service. All right, I think we're going to wrap up here. Thank you very much, Edsel, for coming on this morning, for sacrificing your Saturday morning for our edification.
It was a light affliction.
Praise the Lord. We really appreciate it. And thank you for the reminders in this to depend on God daily. I mean, we say the Lord's Prayer quite often. Mm-hmm. And it's a good reminder. I mean, this is a daily dependency. That's where God wants us. And I feel like that's why he cares about the poor, is because they are dependent, and we are to be dependent. Whether we have more or less, we still are to be dependent on our Heavenly Father.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for the challenges and for the teaching. God be with you as you serve there in your community, in your different capacities, and as you seek to glorify the Lord and expand the kingdom there. God bless you, each one of you who joined us this morning. I assume that you have been as blessed as I have in this. And before we go, we don't have a meeting next Saturday. It's off Saturday, but the following one, May 7th, we're going to hear from Bryant on hospitality worthy of a Jesus embassy. So come May 7th with your hearts ready to hear more about the kingdom of heaven and its effect on our homes and how we open up our homes to the world around us. Brother Edsel, would you close us in prayer?
Sure, let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this day and for your kindness and generosity to us, particularly in what Jesus has done for us through his death and his suffering, and that by his stripes we are healed. Lord, we thank you for for your willingness to pour out yourself for us, and just ask that we might do the same thing for our fellow man, that we would use the resources that you give us, whether it's our social capital or our economic capital, to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Farewell.
Farewell. God be with you all. Grace and peace.
As iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend.